We'll call the hearing to order, and I'd like to welcome everybody for being here, or welcome everybody to the hearing room. Today, we're going to welcome for the first time to the committee the Honorable Maria Contreras-Sweet, the 24th Administrator of the Small Business Administration. Since being confirmed as Administrator and a member of President Obama's Cabinet in April of this year, Administrator Contreras-Sweet has been responsible for leading the SBA in its wide array of programs. In addition to overseeing the agency, including its loan portfolio worth more than $100 billion, the Administrator is responsible for positioning the SBA to succeed in the years ahead. And with this hearing, we plan to both examine the current management of the agency and develop better insight as to how the SBA is poised itself to tackle future challenges in a dynamic economic climate. We all know that small business are the engines of our economy and responsible for the creation of two-thirds of all new jobs. And access to capital is critical to these job creators. In the last fiscal year, the SBA supported more than $29 billion in lending to small businesses. And this is led by the 7A loan program, which guaranteed over $17 billion in lending and is on pace to do so again this year. The SBIC program also had another record year, and the 7A and 504 loan programs required less taxpayer dollars to operate last year than in any since the recession. While there have been recent successes, fundamental concerns associated with the SBA's management remain. As the committee has expressed before, the agency continues to create policy without the benefit of notice and comment rulemaking, thereby ignoring valuable input of those affected. And for example, in June, an announcement of a new credit scoring model for loans of under $350,000 was made by an internal agency notice. Additionally, the agency has a history of pursuing initiatives it creates on its own while ignoring congressionally mandated activities. Contracting reforms this committee debated and approved and which were signed into law more than 2 years ago have not been fully implemented, and while resources instead have been devoted to potentially duplicative, unauthorized entrepreneurial development programs dreamed up by the agency with little public input. To assure the agency is accountable and operating in the most efficient manner while reducing risk to the taxpayers, it is critical moving forward that the SBA works with Congress, complies with the law, and engages the public more effectively. We're very fortunate again to have the Administrator here with us today, and we look forward to hearing her perspective and working with her to improve SBA and better serve small businesses. And I now recognize Ranking Member Velasquez for her opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This hearing is timely. While we are not yet seeing the pace of economic growth all of us would like, America's entrepreneurs are creating jobs, growing, and gradually leading us back to prosperity. In August, small firms with fewer than 500 employees led job growth, adding 153,000 positions to the payrolls. At the same time, early August numbers for the broader economy were disappointing. Clearly, the outlook for both our recovery and the small business sector remains mixed. Small businesses do appear poised to ramp up investment in their operations. A recent survey found 51% of companies with less than $20 million in revenue plan to increase capital spending during the next year, investment that will hopefully further fuel growth. Despite positive trends, obstacles remain. Access to capital is a perennial challenge for entrepreneurs. That remains the case today. Even now, lending activity has not returned to pre-recession levels. Commercial loans of less than $1 million, loans that primarily go to smaller companies, remain down by about 20% compared with the year leading up to the financial crisis. At the same time that capital is tight, two-thirds of small companies report rising expenses in running their businesses. Fully a quarter of firms say rising costs are the biggest challenge, making clear the need to expand entrepreneurs' financing options. Likewise, small businesses continue seeking demand for their goods and services. This company has repeatedly examined how small firms and other disadvantaged businesses can benefit with the federal government as a customer. While the federal government may hit its 23% small business contracting goal this year, more can always be done. In all this area, the SBA performs a vital mission, and I just want to take this opportunity to welcome Ms. Contreras-Sweet to SBA as well as looking forward to working with you. SBA credit programs get capital into the hands of small firms by guaranteeing loans that banks might otherwise be unwilling to make. Last year, the agency supported $29 billion in loans to small firms. As commercial credit remains tight for small companies, it is critical the agency continue helping entrepreneurs access capital. Likewise, the agency has a crucial role in ensuring federal agencies meet their small business contracting goals. While hitting the 2013 government-wide goal constitutes progress, it comes after small businesses received short shrift for many years. The entire federal government can and must do better. For aspiring entrepreneurs and early-stage businesses, the SBA is equally important. Studies have consistently shown that federal investment in these programs nets a positive return for the taxpayers. I look forward to hearing how the agency will manage these programs in the future. In all this area, the Small Business Administration can provide an important boost to small companies. And when small businesses succeed, the broader economy does well. In that regard, I look forward to hearing the administrator's views on how the agency is currently functioning, what improvements can be made, and how she plans to strengthen the SBA services to benefit America's entrepreneurs. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for this time, and I yield back.
Okay, testifying before us today is the Honorable Maria Contreras-Sweet, who is the administrator, as we have mentioned, of the Small Business Administration. The administrator oversees the agency's loan portfolio as well as small business counseling and contracting programs. Administrator Contreras-Sweet is a successful entrepreneur, business executive, and former state cabinet official. And prior to taking over the helm at the SBA, she founded the first Latino-formed commercial bank in California in more than 35 years and focused on providing access to capital and counseling to small and mid-sized businesses in Los Angeles. She also started and ran a venture capital firm that invested in small businesses. Administrator, thank you for being here. I look forward to your testimony.
Thank you so much, Chairman Graves, and to you, Ranking Member Velasquez. I'm delighted to be with you and with all of the members of this wonderful committee. Thank you for the opportunity to address you today. Since being confirmed, I've taken time to sit with many of you, and I've come to know that you not only share my passion to promote entrepreneurship, but have been actively engaged in supporting our nation's small businesses. I'm grateful to you. In my engagement with the Chairman and Ranking Member, I have seen firsthand the bipartisan commitment of this committee, working together to help small businesses. At the SBA, our team remains focused on our core mission of facilitating access to capital, counseling, contracts, and disaster assistance. When meeting with our lenders, clients, and borrowers, I understand their concerns because I've been in their shoes as an entrepreneur, 5 years as California's chief bank regulator, and then starting a community bank. This guides my belief that SBA can help more businesses create jobs. I've also learned the significant work that happens in this committee and the importance of working with you to make our programs better and the agency run more effectively. SBA's capital is infusing dollars into local markets and improving our American economy. Small businesses inject capital into the economy more quickly as they cover payroll, buy equipment, and acquire local real estate. This is good so we can stamp more often invented, grown, and made in the USA. In the 21st century, the SBA must be as innovative as the businesses we serve. I want SBA to mean smart, bold, and accessible. Implementing smart systems so our agency keeps pace with the technological advances that change how Americans conduct their business. Championing bold initiatives to open new business channels for entrepreneurs within the federal government, corporate supply chains, and international commerce. And making our services more accessible to small business owners, regardless of their gender, race, age, or neighborhood. From my conversations with Chairman Graves and many of you, we see that the prevailing challenge SBA faces is that our loan documentation is too complex and labor-intensive, forcing banks to hire specialized staff, contract it out, or worse, walk away from loans. We cannot afford to lose these partners and turn job creators away. To combat this, we've launched a predictive business credit scoring model the SBA has been developing for more than a decade, combining an entrepreneur's personal and business credit scores. This new scoring model is now available to all of our lending partners for loans of $350,000 or less, making it easier and less time-consuming for banks to do business with us and for entrepreneurs to do business with them. Strong stewardship of our flagship 7A program has allowed us to keep fees at zero on loans less than $150,000, and we continue to operate it at zero subsidy. The 504 program is moving closer to zero subsidy. Next year, we will roll out SBA One, an interactive, user-friendly platform. It will automate the uploading of documents and generation of forms and allow for electronic signatures. On each 7A loan, the SBA One will save banks hours of processing time and money. The combination of predictive credit scoring and SBA One will incent more banks to partner with us to promote underserved lending, generating more loans, and igniting more economic activity. Being bold means opening new markets, both here and abroad. Over the next decade, new markets around the world are going to open up, but only 1% of small businesses are selling to them. We're focused on ensuring small businesses have the financing they need to engage internationally. I'm pleased to announce that for the first time in 8 years, the federal government met the 23% goal of federal contracting to small businesses in FY13. This was an important achievement, but lamentably, we fell short of our women-owned contracting goal. We must do more to meet it. The face of entrepreneurship is changing in America. Being an accessible SBA is key. More of those faces today belong to women, to Latinos, to African Americans, Asian American, Native Americans, our veterans, and our seniors. To this end, in addition to promoting small dollar loans, we're focusing on building referral networks with microlenders so new businesses can get startup capital. At the SBA, our team is working to find creative ways to put microcapital into the hands of emerging entrepreneurs. While this has been a priority for Ms. Velasquez's, we've all seen too many entrepreneurs with great ideas and products default because of poor financial planning. We look forward to working with her, all of you, and our national network of partners to increase technical assistance to small businesses. Our guarantees allow lenders to make loans they otherwise would not. The SBA fills market gaps. Every dollar we inject into the economy is capital that would potentially have stayed on the sidelines. I thank you for all your bipartisan commitment to small businesses. Mr. Chairman, I'm delighted to take your questions.
All right, we'll start with Mr. Shabbat.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and we're honored to have you here this afternoon, Madam Administrator, and thank you for taking the time to speak with me over the phone last week. I know that you had an opportunity to learn about the Brandery in Cincinnati, which is one of the startup accelerators. It's been quite successful around the country, and the accelerator fund. Looking at the most recent metrics for the SBA's capital access programs, it's clear that the SBIC program is an important one. I think the SBIC program fills a critical gap in the market caused by the financial crisis and to some extent by the burdens on lenders under Dodd-Frank. But many successful SBICs have hit the family of funds limit, and there are many more funds that will hit it if they raise another fund, in other words, if they try to support more small businesses. Mm-hmm. So we should encourage investment in small businesses, not limit it. The administration has previously been supportive of raising this limit. Does the administration still support raising a family of funds limit, and will you work with us to help pass an increase?
Thank you, Mr. Shabbat, for that question. I think the SBIC is a very interesting tool. Just thinking and hearkening back to my banking days, I can share with you that sometimes we don't always have enough to collateralize a loan, and so I find that the notion of providing mezzanine capital, patient capital, is really key, and I am delighted that this program is blooming and more are hearing about the program. I just received another application for an SBIC yesterday, in fact. So I'm pleased to tell you that out of this Office of Innovation and Investment, we were able to shape the growth accelerators to which you just referenced. And I'm pleased to tell you that through that program, we are incubating the incubators, because it's important to connect with those who wanted just some seed capital to get started. I call it sort of angel financing without taking an equity position. So overall, I find that this program is very complementary to the other suite of programs that we have at the SBA, and I am supportive of it. I've been watching that ceiling, and I can share with you that at least so far I haven't seen a challenge with it, but others have come to me, and I would be delighted to come back and work with you to support the ceiling of
thank
that
you.
Opportunity.
Yeah, we'd like to follow up with you and work with you on the family of funds issue. Thank you. Let me ask you this. All of our financial institutions play a role in small business capital formation, and credit unions are no exception. I happened to speak before the credit union folks who were in town this week, this morning for a while. In fact, they experienced a 12% growth in small business loans from last year. Is the SBA trying to collaborate more with credit unions? And if so, could you elaborate on any of those efforts?
Mm-hmm. Thank you again. I have to tell you that I think credit unions are quite special. I think they can play a very important role, considering that they complement the for-profit community of the private lenders, which I was a part of. But I find that their model is quite interesting. And so as soon as I took office, I reached out to the chairman of the regulatory body, Debbie Matz, to engage and to discuss what is the proper role of our credit unions. I was delighted to see their interest in wanting to engage, and I'm pleased to share with you that just recently we are now in the throes of actually pinning an agreement where we can work more collaboratively and collegially. I was just in San Diego meeting with our AARP organization, which is also a marvelous organization. And so the three of us are looking to form a troika, if you will. I think credit unions can play a special role, particularly with respect to micro lending, and that's the target that we're looking at.
Thank you.
And it wouldn't affect their business cap, and so I think that it works, and it would be complementary to what they're doing already. Thank you.
I've got about a minute, so let me just ask you this. You had mentioned that you're interested in engaging internationally, meaning trade, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know if the president's going to expend any political capital anytime in the near future to push some of his allies in the House on TPA, the Trade Promotion Authority, and therefore put us on the road to TPP in the Pacific area, or TTIP in Europe, because international trade is absolutely critical to the economy, and it's kind of a heavy lift, and we haven't really mm-hmm. seen much effort there by the administration at this point. Not you, but your boss.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you for that. I have to tell you that as we see that in the next 10 years, we're going to see about 1 billion new consumers in the middle class join the ranks of the middle class. And so it is important that we keep a keen eye on the international opportunity. Right now, 95% of the world's consumers are outside of the U.S., and only 1% of small businesses are partaking of that opportunity. So I think it's important for us to look at ways in which we help the small business adapt and grow into international strategies. So to that end, you know that we have the STEP program that we use. We have, of course, our USIAC centers that we provide, where we provide services throughout the country. We work collegially with Commerce, with the Ex-Im Bank, with all the others. And the President has indicated that he supports TPP and asked us to get behind it as well. I can't tell you particularly exactly his strategy, but I can tell you that he stands ready to do what he can to encourage small businesses to partake of the enormous international opportunity.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Velasquez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and welcome again,
thank
Ms.
you.
Contreras-Sweet. When, and you mentioned that, and I mentioned in my opening statement, that access to capital is still a challenge for a great number of entrepreneurs. And one of the sectors in our economy that is facing a serious issue in accessing capital is women entrepreneurs. When the Small Business Jobs Act was passed in 2010, we were told that we needed larger loans to help spur the economy. However, lending volume to women-owned firms actually decreased in that time. More shockingly, larger loans seems to have disproportionately benefited male led firms. The gap in average loan size reached almost 50% in 2011 and remains above 35% today. How can we tell women entrepreneurs that the SBA is there for them when such large discrepancies exist? And what do you intend to do about it?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for asking me a question that's very important to me personally. And I started a financial institution because I care deeply about making sure that all people have access to capital in a very consultative and respectful fashion. So to that end, on day one, when I inquired about what the opportunities were, I've learned as a banker that there is no one silver bullet for any target market. We have to make sure that we have a continuum of capital available so that as we grow, that the SBA can continue to be there. Bearing in mind that the SBA is not there to compete with the private capital markets, we're only there to fill the market gaps. And so in that regard, we have a triple, quadruple prong strategy. First, it's the way we consult our women. We have women business centers throughout the country that are helping them understand how to build a solid strategic plan. You all know that you gave us an important tool then in terms of once they have a plan, they need to get work. You gave us an important tool, and that is you said to us a 5% goal on contracting. We're working on that. We haven't reached that goal, but I think we have an opportunity to do more. One of the first things I did as soon as I took office, my initial first trip, was to launch a Challenge Her event to help the word get out and also to promote more matchmaking opportunities. But with respect to capital, all of our efforts have been to make sure that all of the stream of capital is available to everybody. In that regard, and I can tell you that so many bankers always say that they want to get the bigger loans out, and we have to make sure that we're pushing forward on the small dollar loan. So you probably have heard, I know that you've been supportive of the fact that we zeroed out fees on loans under $150,000. We are getting the word out through our micro lending program about that, and we're looking at technical assistance, which I know is so vital. And then, of course, the system that we just recently put in place around the predictive scoring will help community banks get more loans out to women as well.
Administrator, I just would like to hear at least one or two specific steps that you intend to take in order to make sure that when you come to us and ask to increase the cap, so that you could put more money out there, that we benefit a sector that is growing, because we know that women-owned businesses is growing faster than any other group within the economy, but yet they're facing problems in accessing capital. So I just would like to hear that you're going to revise. Look, the 7(a) program, the mission of it, when it was created, was to put money into the hands of able and credit-worthy entrepreneurs that, for whatever reason, had problems accessing capital through traditional banks and traditional lending institutions. So I just would like for you to go back and review the data and see what specific steps you will take. But now I would like to ask you about Superstorm Sandy, because this is close to home. Mm. It happened in New York and the tri-state area. And right after Katrina, we revamped the disaster program, and we provided tools that gave the flexibility for SBA to act quickly and softly and provide the assistance that homeowners and small businesses needed to have in a timely manner so that we could save those businesses that were impacted by any disaster, any natural disaster. Here we are, and the OIG is going to come out with a report on the response of the disaster loan program for Sandy. But what we know is that, once again, the disaster program has been exposed, and it shows the shortcomings as loan processing times average 46 days for small businesses. The budget shows that SBA has requested $186.9 million for disaster administration next year. In what ways will this funding be used to reduce processing delays so that businesses and homeowners can get funds more quickly?
Thank you again, Congressman, for that question as well. Let me just say to you that I can't speak with great specificity about what happened in the past, but what I can tell you is that when we heard about the disaster in the state of Washington, I flew out there immediately to meet with all the people in Oso, Darrington, Arlington community. And I can share with you that within 24 hours of having heard that the disaster was declared, our people were on the beat, and within a few days, money was out the door. And so I think that our systems continue to be refined and continue to evolve and will be strengthened over time. I'm now on it, and I'm delighted to tell you that I think we're making great progress. Moreover, I just met yesterday with those who process our loans to find ways in which we can develop organizational systems to make sure that we're processing those more efficiently and from a more informed basis.
Well, I would like to for you to come back to the committee or send us an answer to my question, because we provided specific areas that you needed to improve and to execute those that were contained within the disaster program legislation that we passed. And some of those tools that were included were not used. And I just would like to know that, in fact, you have implemented so that the next time you are ready to answer and to provide the assistance that those businesses need. About Washington, I don't know. I hear you, but the numbers will tell us whether or not you were able to provide the loans that those businesses needed. Because in New York, many of those businesses are not in existence today. Study shows that when a disaster loan strikes, it will take, if you don't provide response, if you don't provide the assistance that they need within the 4 weeks after a disaster, the probability of those businesses not to succeed and get back on track are very, very high. So after Katrina, now Sandy, I hope and I pray that we will not face any other natural disaster. But we cannot fool ourselves. We know that it will happen again, and we want to make sure that you have everything that you need to have in place so that the administration are able to provide the assistance that those business, that we promise, that this government promise. And with that, I will come back after other members.
I just wanted to add, Ms. Velasquez, that my mother-in-law experienced Northridge earthquake, and I've experienced the riots of Los Angeles, and I want to tell you that disasters are very important to me. I've met with our district offices, I've gone to the sites, and I track our numbers every day, and I'm working with our department directly to assure that every one of our programs is well executed and on time and on target budget-wise. So I thank you for your concern to this topic. I want to assure you that we are on it. Thank you.
Mr. Luke DeMar.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Administrator, I'll take a moment to follow up on a letter that I sent to you, and my colleagues as well, to the agency several months ago. The letter addressed changes to the SOP 50-10F, which we still have some concerns about with the overall policy, but have heard some assurances from SBA that the policy is currently being amended. I'm pleased to hear that. What I'm following up on today is how the changes came to be, which is without any public input. According to UN regulations, it's required to obtain comment from the public on its rules, and given that fact, many of the standard operating procedures governing the loan programs are actually rules under the guise of standard operating procedures. What actions are you taking to ensure that the public can offer comment on changes to SBA standard operating procedures?
Thank you again for that question. We are examining all ways in which the public can engage the SBA. We're using the usual governmental procedures, as well as we're deploying smart systems to make sure that people can communicate with us in the current ways of technology today. And so, for example, we're now launching more initiatives around connecting through the social networks our people are getting out in the field more. We're directing them to get out and to do front-end conversations so that we can be proactive in the community. And I want to assure you that...
Let me interrupt just a second here. Are you advertising this so people who have concerns about it, people who will be in the process of utilizing these services can find this opportunity for themselves? Or is it just stuck on a computer site somewhere and you got to go digging before you can find it?
Thank you for that comment. No, the agency has been very proactive in connecting. We have so many outlets to engage the public. One, we meet regularly with the NAGL partners, our government guarantee lending partners. We meet with people through our women business centers, through our SCORE partners, through our veterans business outreach centers. Our regional administrators are out in the field. Our district directors are out in the field. And our key program lead regularly hold comment opportunities for those who are affected by any of our programs to be able to provide feedback and input.
Well, the concern is that it didn't happen properly on this situation that we're trying to address with the letter. And you're assuring me that that's not going to happen again?
That's correct, sir.
Okay. Following up, in your statement, you say that on each S7A loan, SBA 1 will save banks hours of processing time and money. Do you have a study to show how many hours it's going to save?
I can share with you, Mr. Chairman, that, Mr. Congressman, that as a banker, I can tell you that first and foremost, what we have to do as a banker is accept these loan documents through a fax machine, and we communicate with our client through a fax machine. And so when you consider the smart technology that's available today, it's important to sort of blow up the fax machines and allow our the SBA to be current with...
Yes. Madam Administrator, as a banker, I'm telling you, asking you, where's the information to back up what you said? I deal in facts. This is a statement that should have facts, studies, something backing up. I'm asking you, have you got a study that shows how many hours you're going to save? Yes or no? Do you have a study?
Mr. Chairman, we do have an understanding. We have a very clear understanding that when you cut out paperwork and extra visits and then what you do is once you launch a pilot, then you track the metrics, and then we'll be able to come back and report to you.
So we haven't tracked the metrics yet?
We haven't launched the program yet. So
you don't know how much you're going to save yet?
We will track the metrics.
It may cost more hours.
Mr. Congressman, I have not seen a program that when you take out steps and steps and take out a lot of paperwork that it ends up costing more. I just haven't seen that in my experience.
You're talking to somebody who was with the government here. We deal with this every day. Every day, our constituents are inundated with more regulations, more work. You take off two regulations, you put on five. It happens all the time. And here you're telling us this is a wonderful program. Hope it works. All I'm asking for is documentation that can prove what you just said. And you can't do it.
Mr. Carson,
come to this committee and make statements if you can't back them up. That's my point. And it's a pretty simple request here. It's made on page 2, the bottom of 2 here. I see my time.
As an experienced banker, I can assure you it's going to take some savings, and it will be more efficient. And I'll be delighted to buy you lunch if that doesn't happen, Mr.
Congressman. As a fellow banker, I can tell you this stuff causes me headaches, heartburn, and costs me lots of money because it takes lots and lots of time for my people and my business to adjudicate and work with. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'm hearing great enthusiasm from our banking partners. Thank you so much for your support.
Ms. Chu.
Administrator Contreras-Sweet, welcome.
Thank you.
I have questions about the SBA 7A Guarantee Loan Program and the 504 Loan Program. I know they both fill critical needs in the market for small businesses that can't access traditional lending sources. It's important that these loans reach underserved communities and the small business owners that need them the most. So my question has to do with whether the program is reaching its intended target. Can you tell me about the lending demographics of the 7A loan portfolios of the lenders, such as the types of loans being administered and what types of communities have been receiving the loans for the past 2 years?
Thank you for that question. I'm pleased to say that what we're learning in the loans under $150,000 are dramatically up. We're seeing that the women loans are up, the African-American loans are up over 100%. I believe the women loans were up 35%. Every single target population has gone up since we've zeroed out fees on the 7A loan, on the Community Advantage loan. So we need to continue to push that, because I think that that is where so much of our diversity is looking for capital at the lower end, just to start their business and to grow it. But we need to also continue to provide the continued continuum of capital so that as they grow and scale up, they also have the alternative products available to them.
And can you submit for the record information on whether any of the top 7A lenders have internal loan policies that restrict who gets a 7A loan? For example, do any of these lenders not make loans under a specific size, or only make loans available to certain industries?
I can't speak for every financial institution, but clearly different programs, different banks have different programs. We're encouraging all of our banking partners to partake more and more of the SBA, and that's part of the work that I have underway. I'm also expanding, as I mentioned earlier, that I think it's also important to continue to engage the credit unions. And I also think that it's important that as we think about the continuum of capital, that we also study and examine what role the SBA can play, if any, in helping direct also those seeking to have more access to capital to the alternative financing channels. I was interested, for example, yesterday, you probably heard that the Apple company just launched a pay program, Apple Pay. And so all of those, when you see that Square launched a lending program, when you see that Amazon launched a lending program, so all of these have to be studied so that we understand how the SBA plays in that community to make sure that we are complementary to what's taking place in America.
And so we could get information such as that.
We'd be delighted to look into what we can offer you, and we'd be delighted to reach out to our financial partners to see what we can get you. That's important data, and we track it internally, and I'd be delighted to see what we can share with you, just honoring the Privacy Act and all the other things that we have to honor. But I'm delighted to share with you the data that we're tracking.
Very good. The SBA 504 loan refinancing program helped many small business owners survive the recession and go on to create more jobs and bolster the economy. However, the program expired in 2012. In the last year of the program, over 2,400 small businesses benefited from refinancing over $2.2 billion. I introduced H.R. 1240, the Commercial Real Estate and Economic Development Act, CREED, which would help reauthorize this program. At a time when our economy is still recovering, do you think extending the SBA's 504 loan refinancing program would be beneficial to small business owners?
I had some knowledge of when it was first launched the first time, the first go around, and I can share with you that I thought that it wasn't launched exactly, you know, in a coherent way, at least to us in Los Angeles. And so it took a little while for it to take hold and to get started. But once it did, I thought it was an important tool. And I would be supportive of 504 refi continuance. And I think, in fact, we're hoping that everything will go well, and then you'll see it in our budget soon.
Very good.
Thank you.
You referred a little bit earlier about the goal for women-owned businesses. And I was glad to join you at the Challenger event in Los Angeles to help women-owned businesses get contracts with the federal government. Congratulations on getting the 23% contracting goal for small business met this year. However, the contracting goal for women-owned businesses is 5%, and yet women only got 4.3% of all federal contracts, and that means that they missed out on $2 billion worth of federal contracts. What can we do to finally get to the 5%?
You are right to hone in on that challenge. Women represent half of our population, and we don't. It wasn't, you know, our the old days where we always had, you know, an alternative as to whether we worked or not. So many of us now are the sole providers for our families. So this is a very important body of work, and I can share with you that we will continue to reach out through all of the channels that the SBA has, again, through the vast network of small business development centers to the women business centers. But it's also important that we have an extra tool at every buying activity. When you are there on the ground at the actual buying activity, and that buying officer has an important tool that he has for other hub zone and for our vets, and that is sole source authority. We're seeking sole source authority for women as well so that they can be at the same level and be parity with other disadvantaged groups. And I've also tasked the SBA with expediting the way in which we conduct the study to find if women are found to be underserved in more of the NAICS codes, because we think that if that study proves to be that there are underrepresented in other categories, then that's another tool that the SBA and its officers can use in the field.
Thank you. I yield back.
Mr. Schweiker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Administrator, and forgive me because I'm hearkening back to, I think, one of my very first hearings sitting on this committee a couple years ago on the discussion of the adoption of technology for loan management, for loan servicing, for participating lenders, application process. Wasn't that supposed to come online 2 years ago? Some of that moving from a proprietary system to sort of a more of an open source system. I mean, where are you at right now technology-wise? And why a couple years behind?
Yeah, thank you so much, sir, for that question. Technology is key in executing what we do. When you are now, as the SBA is interacting with financial institutions, that all are deploying some of the smartest systems America has. You recall when, at least when I was growing up, I can speak for myself, you'd go into a bank to actually deposit your check so that you could...
Look, I used to... I've been involved in sort of the technology size of collection. So I'm more just, let's do technology talk instead of, of policy talk.
That's what I was referring to. So in terms of policy,
why the 2 year delay?
So I can share with you that we feel that technology can help us in many ways be more efficient and effective.
With respect to the question you asked. I'm desperately trying not to be rude.
Yes.
I understand that's the same discussion we had a couple years ago. Why the 2 year delay in what was supposed to be the rollout?
Right. Of the seven tranches of work, they have now been all completed. But what I'm wanting to share with you, sir, is that at least in my view, as I see it, it's important that we continue to evolve technology. So I would hope that the SBA never sees that their work in technology is complete.
Okay. So a quick checklist. So loan servicing and management is now no longer in a proprietary system, but on a system that all participating lenders have trackability authority through the web, right?
All of the seven sub-programs under the LMAS have now all been completed.
And so if I'm my community bank or credit union, I can now do my loan applications and my filings all through the web now?
As soon as we complete the SBA 1, which being Q2, then we'll be able to, as I was outlining earlier, we'll be able to do everything online.
And
with respect to the 7A and the 504.
And the 2 year delay on that is just, was it technical issues, contracting issues, security issues? Any idea what drove that?
I can tell you that at this point they're all complete, and I can tell you that technology is an ongoing opportunity for us to continue to be efficient.
And technology will always be an ongoing opportunity. The 2 year delay was because of what?
Mr. Congressman, what I can tell you is that we will continue to evolve, and I hope that technology is never a completed project.
If you have one of your staffers here who actually speaks technology, I would love a response actually to that question to be helpful. There is a conceptual one, and I'd like to move, because I think this is a great opportunity, particularly for minority and underserved populations and everything out there. And even another article that, from 2 days ago that one of the early executives of Google and others are moving into crowd-based funding, crowdsourced lending. It's almost a peer-to-peer type lending, particularly I know our ranking member here has always had an interest in sort of the micro-lending world, and many of us have had how bureaucratic, if you've ever done an SBA loan from, walking in the door and been handed the paper.
I've done a few.
Yeah, it takes your breath away. And that's, how does the world change for the SBA when I have dozens of peer-to-peer lenders out there now who are doing almost a direct loan environment? Does the SBA, have you looked at the technology, remember you were just talking about,
sure,
the future and what's happening around us? Mm-hmm. And the cost of those funds seems to be coming in very competitive because
indeed,
of the lack of staff and bureaucracy and their technological way of doing credit modeling. Does that change the world of access to capital?
I think it does. I absolutely think that these are all very encouraging developments. When I met with Acción, Kiva Zip, Cabbage, PayPal, Square, all of these I think are wonderful developments, and I think it's important for the SBA to examine, as I was referencing earlier, that we examine what proper role we have in understanding which ones are working effectively, again, track their performance accountability, and then be able to properly counsel small businesses so they can navigate through those strategies.
Would there ever become a time if certain categories had very egalitarian access to capital? Because I have a couple apps now where you can actually on crowdsource loans for your small business right off your phone, that the SBA would say this market now is appropriately served, our needy populations are receiving, that the SBA will come here to Congress and say, job well done, the market found a way to serve this, we're now going to go someplace else.
Yeah, I think your question is a really important one, and that's why as soon as I arrived at SBA, I launched the Smart, Bold, and Accessible initiative, because I think it is important for Congress to allow us to be flexible, to allow us to evolve, to make sure that we're addressing the emerging technological advances, not just to provide access to capital, but for counseling. We have international opportunities that we can also use technology for. And so I think that these will all present new opportunities for the SBA.
And forgive me, Mr. Chairman, for going over the time. It's an area of personal interest. Thank you, Madam Administrator.
Ms. Hahn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, ranking member. Thank you, Madam Administrator Contreras-Sweet, for being here today. I'm very pleased that you're in this position. I think you come to this position at a great time. We're coming out of the recession. Small businesses are becoming successful. They're growing. You and I both grew up in Los Angeles, and I know you were in Los Angeles just recently talking about some of your initiatives. And a lot of my questions have been asked, but I did want to just a couple of things. One was just to hear you talk a little bit more about what we can do to reach out to our women-owned and minority businesses. I know before the recession, women-owned small businesses were receiving 40% of the SBA loans. Now they're receiving just 16%. African-American entrepreneurs have gone from receiving 11% of the SBA loans to just 2.3%. So I don't like that trend. So I would love to hear. I do think some of the changes that you've implemented, the not charging the fees for the loans, is going to be valuable. And I know you've already seen an impact from that. Wondering if enough changes have been made, or are there other things that we should look at changing? And then I meet with small businesses all the time. It's one of the things I do. And by the way, you have some great folks on the ground in Los Angeles. Victor Parker is a star, and he has worked with me on every roundtable I've had. We've done stuff with the Port of Los Angeles, connecting our small businesses with the international trade industry, and he's terrific. The other complaint I get from a lot of my small businesses, particularly some of the new startups, not really clear on how they can access small business resources. They're not really sure what the SBA is or does. How do they access them? Is there a better way we can outreach to our small businesses, particularly the new ones, on what's available? Because listening to you, there's a ton of stuff that's available and innovative and creative that you're really going to be implementing. And how do we get that word out to visit? So two things. One, women, minority-owned businesses, and then could we do a better job of outreach?
Thank you. And it's good to see you again, too. Thank you for your support while we were in Los Angeles. I can share with you that one of the things, and I think it addresses also the earlier question, and that is how do we evolve as an organization to meet the challenges of today's economy? And so to that end, that's why I launched the Smart, Bold, and Accessible Initiative. We are examining the ways in which we can modernize the agency to make sure that we're current and relevant in today's technological pace. And so in that regard, we are examining all the smart systems that are currently out there in the private marketplace and to understand how we can complement those systems in SBA. Who are they reaching effectively and who are they not? And where should we be to make sure that we're filling that gap? So that's an important role. In that regard, Madam Congresswoman, what we did is launched a program that we call Vera VSIP, which is where we offer those who have served the SBA so well, so elegantly, and have helped to create 2 out of 3 new jobs that we're finding in America. But some of them are saying, it's time for me to return and spend more time with my family. And so in that regard, we are offering some of our employees early retirement. What that will allow us to do is to reexamine how we deploy our personnel to more effectively and strategically respond to today's and tomorrow's challenges. So that's one, how we align our personnel.
You better not redeploy Victor Parker.
Well, and to that point, I have traveled now the country and meeting with our district offices, and in each district, I hear a story about how special our district officers are, so I'm delighted that you had that kind of experience. But the second thing that I wanted to say is for our women, Native American, African Americans, Latinos, and women, Asian Americans, we need to make sure that we are accessible to all. And that's why the S, B, and the A stands for accessible. And so, again, how do we use technology? How do we outreach to these communities? How do we make sure that our products are being responsive? Setting our fees at zero for loans under $150,000 will help and go a long way. Tracking and meeting regularly with the financial institutions, both the private and the public sector, the credit unions, who have now, again, we've reached out to them, and they've accepted the challenge of doing more of the small dollar loans. And by that, Ms. Congresswoman, I'm speaking to the loans under $50,000, which is where many women who just want to start their business want to be. And so I'm focused on the 3 initiatives: access to capital through every channel that's available to the SBA. I'm committed to making sure that through our vast network of national network of small business development centers and all of the other partners, that we are reaching out to women to talk to them about the strategies to make sure that they have a proper plan in place for their optimal success. And the third piece of it is just in general to make sure that we are getting contracting opportunities to women in 3 avenues. First, with the federal government, the U.S. is the largest procurer in the world. We want to make sure that we meet the goal 5% with women. Second, we want to make sure that we are working to make sure that more women benefit from the private sector supply chain. To that end, the president announced a 15-day pay period. So in 15 days, the federal government pays small businesses. For me, having been in a small business and having a large corporation hold me up for 90 days, I'll tell you, 15-day is sweet music to me. That was an important tool. And so we're challenging the private sector in their supply chain to follow our lead. And the third is how we help small businesses partake of the largest growing market, and that's outside of the U.S.
Ms. Meng?
Thank you, Chairman Graves and Ranking Member Velasquez, and I too want to congratulate you, Madam Administrator, and thank you for the tremendous job that you've been doing, especially in terms of outreach since day one. A few months ago, we had a field hearing with our subcommittee with Chairman Richard Hanna of the subcommittee and our Ranking Member Nydia Velasquez in our district in New York, and talked a lot about the issues that a lot of minority and women-owned businesses face in terms of accessing capital and lack of outreach. And I do want to thank the SBA members of your team for coming to our district recently to explain the new lending program to a lot of our local community banks, especially the banks that serve minorities. So I just want to emphasize that whatever we can do here in Congress to continue to spread the word and help with outreach, I think will continue to be very important. My question is actually about veterans. I know that the SBA has a Boots to Business pilot program that so far has relied heavily on internet-based video instruction. And I just wanted to know, have you found that to be effective? And what's the rationale for relying on online training modules as opposed to maybe person-to-person?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think that's an important question. I can't tell you how proud I am to know that the SBA is connected with those who are defending our freedoms and upholding our values. And so it is important that the SBA continue to refine and continue to expand the Boots to Business program. It is largely electronic because we're in all of the world installations, and so this works so that first, I think while people are still in service, they're trying to examine what they're going to do next, and many times their first, and appropriately so, their first thought is, how do I just get home and be with my family again? And so you want to just begin to give them some exposure. So the first is, you know, a couple of hour video and then an 8-hour program. And then we finally launch into the fuller program. And so it's an important, you know, it's important to allow them to ease into the thought to explore entrepreneurship. But once they're back at home and back in their communities, then we have the full panoply of programs that the SBA offers. Our VBOX centers, the Veterans Business Outreach Centers, the SBDCs, our SCORE partners are out there. And the SCORE partners often go to your place of business to give you personal advice. And so I would hope that then once they're back in their community, that they can partake of the full panoply of offerings that the SBA community has in the communities.
Thank you. I yield back.
I should just add one more that I'm also really proud of because, you know, I know that you also care about women. And so marketing is becoming increasingly digitized, you know, where you have to make it more and more personal. And so we learned from our women armed forces folks that they're very interested in having their own program. And so we launched a specialized training that we call VYs, Veterans Inspiring Spirit, the Spirit of Entrepreneurship. And I was in New York to help launch that program. And there was just such a great dynamic to see that taking place. That program is done in partnership with Syracuse University, which also has more services there available for them.
Ms. Velasquez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Administrator, in the Small Business Goaling Report released by your agency for the last fiscal year, it shows that the overall small business goal of 23% was finally achieved. And some of the members made reference to that. But when you look at the list that is included in your report, I just would like to ask you if you are aware that Northrop Grumman, Raytheon, and Chevron has been included, those contracts, as small business contracts by some of the agencies. I don't know how, I don't know when did they become small businesses, but I am asking you, were you aware that agencies were taking credit toward their small business contracting goal by the fact that they included contracts that were given to large companies?
Madam Ranking Member, in reviewing the list, I had a similar question, and when I took a deep dive to understand what the question, what the answer was to that important question, what I learned is that we have a rule in place that says that once you get in a contract with government, that you are given 5 years, and so if a large company acquires a small business, then it is grandfathered in for a number of years, and so that is one of the instances that we identified. But I can assure you, and the really important thing is that the SBA has disbarred more companies than in the last 4 years than has happened in the last 10 years combined. So I want to assure you that the program is working and that we're delighted that we have met the goal and that now small businesses are getting their fair share.
So would you make a commitment with this committee that you're going to go back and assess and review every contract that was given to these companies so that you could assure us that they are not in violation of the contracting goals to small businesses and the numbers are not being cooked by some of the agencies?
I can share with you that the community has strong policing activities. That
no,
the
you don't,
penalty
or not, maybe now, but Administrator, let's be clear. The GAO conducted an investigation, and we held a hearing when that report was released. And what it shows is that many contracts that were intended to go to small businesses were given to large companies. And that is in violation. So I just want to make sure that we don't ask the GAO to go and do another investigation, and it's going to show again that the proper oversight within the agency is not in place, and therefore this kind of situations happen again. That's all I'm asking you. Because at the end, those small business contractors that are playing by the rules are the one losing out.
I can share with you that I am keenly committed to making sure that small businesses get their fair share. The president asked me to do three things: run an effective SBA, be a voice for small businesses, and help take them to the next level. In that regard, we want to make sure that they get the 23% that they deserve. And I consider that, by the way, a floor, not a ceiling. And so in that regard, we are amping up. We are challenging more. I can tell you that our people are motivated, and they come in and they tell me about, you know, what they're doing out there to make sure that they're speaking up and fighting for small businesses. We pass hundreds of thousands of contracts, and so generally the system is working, and I'm proud to say that our team is on it. They're good cops on the beat, and the policing mechanisms that we have in place are working. And as I said, we have disbarred more abusers in the last 4 years, and the penalties are stiff, and we will continue to convey the message that we are going to have a zero tolerance policy. Thank you.
Mr. Collins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for coming in today. I guess, you know, my question is, whenever I hear about a new program like SBA 1, on the one hand, that's good news. The only concern would be, in the past, we'll use the word past, the GAO and the SBA's Inspector General both have, on occasion, found some problems with the SBA's management of information technology. So now, as we're looking at a new program, can you share with us some of your thoughts about how you're going to make sure that's integrated, is seamless, works well, and motherhood and apple pie?
Thank you so much, Mr. Collins. Again, I think technology can be a very important tool for us, and that's why I launched at the agency an initiative that I call Smart, Bold, and Accessible, which really refers, the underpinning really is how we modernize the SBA. And so I think technology investments can be key in helping us become more efficient and effective throughout the system. SBA 1 will be complementary. And the good news is that it's adding functionality from an existing contract that we already have. And so we're able to continue to manage all of our programs to make sure that they are seamless. And I'm delighted to say that I look forward to coming back and sharing with you how effective the SBA 1 will become. We think that it's going to increase lending in our 7A, our core lending product, and allow more people to get these loans that otherwise would be sitting on the sidelines.
So did part of this come from the lenders or from the borrowers, where they would say another vehicle like this could be useful? So is this, if I'm a small business, am I going to go to SBA 1 to initially apply for a loan, or is it something I'm going to apply to my lender and he's going to use SBA 1?
Thank you for that clarifying question. It is a platform that we're setting up for our lending partners. And so we process our loans through our lending partners. So what the client will see is just a much cleaner interface. And more important, they'll be able to do e-consent. So many times when you're an entrepreneur and you're fighting, you're the CMO and you're the CFO and the CEO, you don't always have time to go into the financial institution. So now this will be able to all be done online. And we'll have the e-signatures, the e-verify that you see on other products in the commercial space, and so they'll have a seamless interaction with their financial institution, and that institution will do the same with us through this platform.
So would the borrower initiate his loan request through SBA 1, the borrower?
No, I'm sorry. I apologize if I didn't clarify. No, it will still be the bank that will initiate the loan, but they will now be able to interact with their borrower online, and that the lender will be also be able to interact with the SBA now online.
So it generates out of the lender, but the small business can be using it as well as the portal of information?
Yes, financial institutions already have largely the e-consent in these tools. The challenge has been that SBA has not been able to interact with the institution online. And now this will facilitate that intermediary role that the bank relies upon. They will now be able to also be online. So most financial institutions have already had this technology. Now the SBA is catching up.
Well, I am glad to hear you're aware of what we would be asking, which is about how it actually rolls out, and I'm confident you'll be reporting back very good results. Thank you very much. I yield back,
it,
Mr.
Sir.
Chairman.
I just have one quick request. Back in March, we sent a letter to the SBA. And we were asking for about 145 separate requests on information concerning the process by which the SBA reviews franchise agreements, and they – at that time, the agency said that they needed to address some concerns or some issues that they had and raised in the letter, and so I agreed to delay that, the compliance with that. And so that was about 6 months ago. I'm just curious when we can expect some answers or some revisions.
Thank you again for that question, Mr. Chairman. The franchising opportunities are vast and complex. And I can tell you that at first blush, I think the notion of a plug-and-play company is really attractive. You know, for small businesses, when we go out to launch a business, first you have to think about, you know, how you're going to lay out your plan, how you're going to brand it, how you're going to create a niche market, how you build barriers to entry, how you attract customers, your marketing initiatives. And so when you contemplate a franchise, it's really a wonderful tool that you can come in with a branded name, you can come in with an institution that already has, you know, addressed the branding question and has mentoring in place. So these are very attractive programs for the small business person. So I'm very interested on this. I've met with the association to understand where they're headed and reviewed with our general counsel and our capital access and our partners to understand exactly what the opportunities are. And I could share with you that we are clarifying these more and more. We're staffing it up because I think this is an important alternative. And we'll be sure to get you those answers that you asked in the letter that we reviewed. Thank you.
Soon, I hope.
Yes, of course, sir. So,
any other questions? With that, we are honored to have you testify before the hearing, and we look forward, I think the whole committee looks forward to working with you in the future on issues, obviously, that you're facing and that we feel that the country's facing when it comes to small businesses. And with that, I would ask unanimous consent that all members have 5 legislative days to submit statements and supporting materials for the record. And without objection, that
Mr. Chairman, if I may, before you adjourn, I don't know if I'll have another opportunity to come before you again. And so I just wanted to publicly acknowledge your leadership and thank you so much for your stalwart effort in leading the Small Business Committee. You know, small businesses are creating so much of the economic activity in this country, and your leadership is well recognized and appreciated. Thank you so much, sir. Well,
thank you very much. I appreciate that. And this is my second to last hearing. Well, there will be one more. But with that, this hearing is adjourned. Thanks.